Jesus is the answer for the world today.
Good morning, everyone. Pastor Esther here with another devotional. I'm so glad that once more you have joined me as we go into God's word to hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying. Before we do that, I just want us to go through a quick recap of what we've been talking about. We started off this year determined and talking about the fact that Jesus needs to be the center of our lives and everything that we are and everything that we do in 2021. Jesus has to be the converging point of all that we are, and everything that we do should converge out of Jesus, him being the main focus, source, and goal of everything we do in this life. We also talked about some of the things that are hindering Jesus from being the center of our lives. And what is that? That's predominantly idols. What is an idol? An idol is basically anything or anyone that we ascribe the worship, the praise, the glory that belongs to God. An idol is anything or anyone that we place our hope and our confidence in. An idol is anyone and anything that has taken up the place, the position, and space in our hearts, in our minds, and in our lives that completely belong to God. And so we need to clear out our idols, because God is clear. He's very clear in Exodus 20 when he told the children of Israel that they should worship no other gods except for him. And Jesus reiterated this same truth in the gospel when he told us, a new commandment I give unto you. And what is that commandment? That we should love the Lord our God with all our hearts, with all our souls, with all our mind, with all our strength. Jesus is telling us that all that we are should love God. So how do we actually start to move idols out of our lives? And how do we ensure that nothing takes the place of God in our hearts, in our minds, in all that we are? Well, it's actually very simple. And what is it? It's that we need to remember the cross. Yes, we always must keep the cross at the forefront. So what do I mean by the cross? I'm talking about we must always remember what Jesus did for us on Calvary, because it is actually the crux of our belief in Christianity. And what is that? It's that God came down in the form of man, Jesus, and he came for one purpose, and he came to die for my sins, your sins, and the sins of the whole world, past, present, and future. And he came to die for our sins because we all sin. The Bible says all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. The Bible also says that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus. So by Jesus's death on the cross, he stood in the place that you and I deserve to be put in, because the punishment for our sins against God is death. But God came and instead took that punishment upon himself. And in exchange, he gives us the free gift of eternal life, that if we receive him as our Lord and Savior, then we are promised the assurance and the hope that when our life is over on this earth, we will be in eternity with God in his presence forever and ever. This is the whole gospel. This is the good news. And why did God do this for us? The Bible talks about that God proves his love towards us, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. John 3:16, one of the famous, most famous scriptures out there, tells us that God so loved the whole world that he gave his only begotten son, that whomsoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life. God's motivation to save humanity from their sinfulness was love. And within his love was his mercy, was his justice, and his goodness. So here is this awesome and amazing person who created the whole universe. When he spoke, things existed. He created us. And when we messed up, instead of leaving it onto us, he came down to save us and to restore us back into relationship with God. And scripture now tells us that now we are at peace with God the Father through Jesus Christ the Son. We are forever at peace with God when we accept Jesus's gift of eternal life. And when we remember this truth, we will always put Jesus at the forefront, because then we will love him wholeheartedly, because we have an understanding of the great sacrifice and goodness of God because of the cross. Join with me as we go to scripture that talks about this love for God. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 14, this is what it says. It says, "For Christ's love compels us, since we have reached this conclusion, if one died for all, then all died. And he died for all so that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for the one who died for them and was raised." See, when we understand that God loves us, and we understand that in his love for us, he sacrificed his life so that we could have life, that truth should generate love in our hearts that compels us to live for Jesus. It compels us to put aside all other things and say that I am going to put Jesus first. So if you've ever heard this story before, and for those of us who are believers, and you're asking yourself the question, well, I know this story, but sometimes it just feels like I don't have that much love or vigor or passion or fervency for God. It's because we're not meditating on God's truth. You know, we live in a time and in a culture where there's so many things that are fighting for our attention. There's so many distractions out there. You know, this device that we all walk around, the phone, it does amazing things, but it can also be an amazingly big stumbling block. So often as believers, I believe today, we are not taking the time to really think on who God is and what he has done for us. The Bible talks about meditating on the word day and night. So many scriptures talk about this pattern of us in the morning thinking about God and his word, us as we lay at night thinking about God and his word. So I want to challenge you, and I want to encourage you to think about the gospel, the good news. Think about the work of the cross. Think about the salvation message in your free time, in your busy time, in your downtime, in your uptime, in the morning, in the noon, and in the afternoon. And I know that what is going to happen is as we give God the space of meditating on this truth, what we're going to find is this absolute profound message of God's love and goodness towards us. And that love, as the scripture says, will compel us. Another version of the scripture says it constrains us. And what does it constrain us to do? It constrains us to live for Jesus. And when we're living for Jesus, then there are no idols in our lives. He becomes number one. And Jesus begins to take his rightful place as King and as Lord over all we are and all we do. So be encouraged, everyone, that let's go back to the Word of God. Let's go back to the beginning. Let's go back to the scripture. Let's go back to the gospel and meditate upon God's amazing love and abounding mercy towards us. So let's pray. Father, I just pray for myself and everyone that's watching this morning, that Lord, you would help us. Remind us of the gospel, Lord. Remind us of the great work of the cross and the abundant breadth and depth of your love towards us, so that as your word says, that love will constrain us. It will compel us to live for you, because indeed, God, the very best thing we can do in our lives is to live for you. So Lord, ask for the grace to meditate upon your word. And I know that as we do so, we will be blessed. We will be transformed in you. We thank you, Father, for this word. For in Jesus' name we pray, amen. Thank you for joining me, and I'll see you next week. God bless.